Hello everyone, I'm Shashi Singh, Assistant Professor at APJ School of Architecture and Planning. Today's lecture is regarding vernacular architecture of Africa, which is a part of world's vernacular architecture and comes under Module 3 of RAR 409, that is vernacular architecture of fourth semester under AKTU syllabus. Before we discuss the vernacular architecture of various parts of Africa, we need to know few things about Africa. Firstly, we can have brief introduction of this wonderful place on earth. Africa is the second largest continent that covers around 1/5 of the total land surface. 10% of overall population of earth. Africa name is derived from Latin word Africa, which means sunny, and Greek word Africae, which means without cold. Most of the part is inhabited by black people, but they also had several immigrations from Asia and Europe earlier. So there were many foreign settlements, out of which Arabs had major impact, who spread the Islamic region into many areas of Africa. Africa is rich in natural resources, but economy is majorly based on agriculture. While studying the geographical setting of Africa, we find that it is bounded by Atlantic Ocean on west side, Mediterranean Sea on the north side, Red Sea and Indian Ocean on the eastern side, and on the south side it has the blending waters of the Atlantic and the Indian Oceans. The continent is almost divided equally in two by the equator, and most of the Africa lies within the tropical regions, that is bounded on the north by the Tropic of Cancer and on the south by Tropic of Capricorn. Africa can be considered as a vast plateau, which is majorly divided into two parts, southeastern portion and western portion. The surface of the plateau is higher at the southeast and tilts downward towards northeast. The major drainage basins of Africa are Nile, Niger, Congo, Zambezi, Orange River, and Lake Chad. Places which are at extreme parts of Africa are Tunisia on northern side, South Africa on southern side, Somalia on eastern side, and Senegal on western side. There are many islands which are associated with Africa, and out of which Madagascar is the most significant. African regions are divided into six parts, that is Central Africa, Eastern Africa, North Africa, Southern Africa, and Western Africa. Africa is very rich in culture, art, and traditions. Africa has certain style which is reflected in their sculptures, paintings, pottery, rock art, textiles, masks, personal decorations, and jewelry, etc. African dance involves music, theater, and rhythmic bodily movement, which reflects the social fabric of Africa. Various musical instruments are used during performances, celebrations, or on certain occasions. The climate of Africa is dominated by desert conditions, mainly in northern and southern regions, having wetter or semi-arid central portion. The continent is majorly divided into 8 climatic regions, that is the hot desert, semi-arid, tropical wet and dry, equatorial, Mediterranean, humid subtropical, warm temperate, and mountain regions or highlands. The traditional settlement patterns in Africa varies in landscape, ecology, etc. Most common one is scattered villages and hamlets consisting of homestead, joint and extended families, which are big enough for defense and domestic cooperation. But these houses were not permanent, as the building materials used are not long-lasting. Moreover, they have to shift to other cultivation lands. In Western African savanna, houses are made of large mud adobe, whereas in most of Africa, traditional houses are constructed from mud, wattle, having roofing materials as thatch or palm leaves. Areas bordering the lakes in the river basins are densely populated, whereas desert and savanna areas have sparsely populated settlement. We will discuss about vernacular architecture of certain areas of Africa like Sudan, Tunisia, South Africa, Cameroon, Mali, Ethiopia, Togo, Morocco, and Burkina Faso. Before studying the vernacular styles and buildings of these places, we need to know their climatic zones in brief, which we'll discuss in detail of each place in later slides. So we'll start with Sudan. Sudan comes under hot desert zone, Tunisia warm temperate zone, South Africa temperate zone, Cameroon tropical zone, Mali intertropical zone, Ethiopia tropical zone, Morocco Mediterranean zone, and Burkina Faso hot and dry zone. Now, one by one, we are going to discuss in detail. Starting with Sudan, this is the vernacular building in Sudan called Tukel. Sudan is a country which is located in northeastern Africa. The name Sudan is derived from an Arabic word Bilad al-Sudan, which means land of the blacks. Sudan was under colonial holding for more than a century and then became independent. Earlier, it was the largest African country with a land area of 8% of the total African land and 2% of the total land of the world. But Sudan is one of the poorest and least developed countries in the world, having 1/3 population depending on farming and animal husbandry for livelihood. The geographical settings is discussed here. Sudan is bounded by Egypt on north side. On the east side, it is bounded by the Red Sea, Eritrea and Ethiopia. On south by South Sudan, on the west by the Central African Republic and Chad, and on the northwest by Libya. Sudan is mainly composed of vast plains and plateaus that are drained by the Nile River and its tributaries. The dominant physical feature of Sudan is the Nile River system. Now we'll discuss the climate of Sudan. Sudan is a hot country. The average annual temperature in central and eastern areas is in between 30 degrees to 40 degrees Celsius. Mean temperature of whole country is 20 degrees Celsius, having highest temperature before rainy season. West and northwest have average temperature between 10 degree to 20 degree Celsius. The rainfall varies from nothing in the north and center to 500 to 750 mm annually in the south. Settlement pattern of Sudan. The rural settlements in Sudan is generally clustered along water bodies due to the water supply problems in dry months. Type of houses differ from regions to region. In the northern part and some central and southern part of Sudan, houses are made of sun-dried bricks having flat-topped roofs, whereas in south, round huts are constructed having conical roofs which are made from grass, millet stalks and wooden poles called tukels. In central, southern and western Sudan, walls constructed of millet stalks generally surround the building compounds. In this slide, we can see various traditional things of Tuposa people of Sudan. Traditionally, men used to wear a piece of cloth wrapped around his body, and women used to wear leather skirts according to their age and marital status, which are embellished with different colored beads. The daily wear differs from the one worn on festive occasions. There was a tradition of scarification which was common for both men and women. Women were expert in basket weaving and other bamboo craft. This is a vernacular house of the Tuposa people of southern Sudan called Tukul, the beehive homes. Tuposa are one of the biggest tribal groups of Sudan who live in the southeastern border. The Tuposa culture is orally transmitted through songs, dance, music, poems, and folk arts. Generally, the homes are built by women and men tend to cattle hut. The Tuposa tribal people of Sudan live in well-organized villages which had separate houses for dry and rainy season and for granaries where they keep their food and valuables. The picture shows above is a typical home called a tukul, which is already being told. The external structure is a temporary scaffolding for the thatcher. The framework of the house is generally made from many strands of small branches bound together with twine. The detail of process of construction is shown in later slides. The structure can either be placed on ground for dry season or raised on stilts for rainy season. Raised structures were usually used for granaries, which provided shade to animals and create a workplace which is shaded and comfortable. Materials used for constructing roof are grass, bamboo poles, rope which is called dinka, and thick rolls of vine. Firstly, the framework is built of bamboo. Next process includes positioning of poles and tying with dinka ropes. After this process, thatching of roof is done. When we look at the sizes and dimensions of these houses, we find that the diameter is approximately 14 feet to 16 feet and the height of the house on ground is approximately 7 feet to 8 feet. And one above the stilts is 14 feet to 16 feet. The openings are very small, maybe approximately 3 feet by 3 feet. These are vaulted adobe homes of Tunisia, having typical semicircular roof which suits the climatic condition of Tunisia. Tunisia is a country in North Africa, and its accessible Mediterranean Sea coastline and strategic location have attracted conquerors and visitors in past. Tunisia's culture is highly diverse because of long period of Ottoman and then French rule, and also due to population of Jews and Christians have lived among a Muslim majority for centuries. Geographical settings of Tunisia. Tunisia is bounded on the west and southwest side by Algeria, by Libya on southeast and Mediterranean Sea to the east and north. Tunisia is characterized by moderate relief. The major drainage feature is the Majerda River. Tunisia is in warm temperate zone. Northern side has Mediterranean climate and southern side has semi-arid condition. Saharan influences give rise to the Sirocco, a seasonal hot blasting wind from south that can have serious drying effect on vegetation. Highest recorded temperature in Africa, that is 55 degrees Celsius, was in Tunisia only. A mean annual rainfall of approximately 1520 mm occurs. Promiere Mountains in northwestern Tunisia, which makes it wettest region in North Africa. As we move towards southwest, less than 100 mm annual rainfall occurs. Tunisia is divided into four natural and demographic regions. First is north part, which is fertile and well watered. Second is central region, which is semi-arid. Third is east central coastal region, which is olive growing country. And fourth is desert south, where there is very less vegetation. In central and southern regions, there are still people who have nomadic life. In north and east long coasts, population is mixed and more dense. These are vernacular vaulted adobe homes of people of Tunisia. This is a vaulted adobe that is called Ghorfa. Castle called Kasar is designed as a fortified granary which stands on a defensive hilltop in the southern Tunisia. The Kasar, that is castle, consists of two courtyards each with a perimeter of multi-storied vaulted adobe cellars. The homes are built alongside similar but generally taller granaries which are called Ghorfa. The whole complex is a fortified settlement having only one entrance. The granaries kept the food cool and dry because of the thick adobe walls and palm wood door, which is a poor conductor of heat. The homes were also cool because of the use of the same materials. These are the pics showing various vaulted adobe buildings in Tunisia, which are generally multi-story, that is 3 to 4 story high, having floor-to-floor height of approximately 2.7 meters. Openings are smaller, having door openings as 0.75 meter by 2.1 meter. Windows of size 0.75 meter by 0.9 meters. On the right side, pictures of Tunisian pottery work and musical instruments are shown. Now we'll discuss the vernacular architecture of South Africa. The most remarkable one is Basotho Hut. Another vernacular dwelling unit of South Africa is Zulu Hut, which is also very significant vernacular building over here, which we'll be discussing. South Africa is the southernmost country on the African continent, which is famous for its varied topography, natural beauty, and cultural diversity. South Africa lies away from the major African cities. Nowadays, it has a stable mixed economy. When we study the geographical settings, we see that South Africa is bordered by Namibia on northwest side, by Botswana and Zimbabwe on the north side, by Mozambique and Swaziland on the northeast and east side. Lesotho is an independent country in the eastern part of the republic, entirely surrounded by South African territory. South Africa's coastline border the Indian Ocean to the southeast and Atlantic Ocean to the southwest. It also possesses two small sub-Antarctic islands. A plateau covers the largest part of the country, which dominates the topography. The Orange River, which rises in the Lesotho Highlands and its tributaries, especially Caledon and the Vaal, drain the greater part of the country. South Africa falls under temperate zone, having mostly dry climate. Summers are warm to hot, and daytime temperature ranges from 21 to 32 degrees Celsius. Higher elevations have low temperature, and at night the temperature falls up to 17 degrees Celsius. Winters are mostly cool to cold, with many higher areas having temperatures below freezing at night. More than one-fifth of the country is arid and receives less than 200 mm of rainfall annually, whereas half of it is semi-arid, which receives 200 to 600 mm precipitation annually. More than 9/10 of the people live in eastern part of the country and southern coastal region. Majority of the rural settlement is owned by whites, even though blacks originally settled there. Traditional black settlements consist of family villages. The land was owned by the community, and the chief granted each household the right to build home as well as cultivate. Pastoral land around the area was used communally. Around one-sixth of the black population lives on farmland owned by whites. This is a Basotho hut which has a roof of strong grass which lasts up to 20 to 30 years and keeps the interior cool during summer and traps heat in winter without any water seepage. The village teaches natural living, the identification and use of herb. Basotho arts and crafts include Lithma, which are mural decoration which are made by Basotho women on traditional homes in Lesotho. The Basotho largely relied on agriculture and animal husbandry for their food supply. The images on the left shows the sizes of hut and its openings. The height of huts is approximately 3 meter, having size of windows as 0.6 meter by 0.6 meter and size of door openings as 0.75 meter by 8 meter by 8 meter to 1 meter by 1.5 meter. Images shown in the middle shows the stage wise construction. First, the wall is erected, which is rubble masonry, above which conical shape framework is made of bamboo or wood, which is then covered with thatch. Extreme right images show the interior of the Basotho hut, which gives us an idea about their storage shelves in the walls, floors, sitting and sleeping areas, etc. It is a single space having different activities in different areas. The bottom right corner shows the detail of patterned mud wall of a traditional South African Basotho hut. The Zulus are a native South African tribe who traditionally live in beehive-shaped dwellings made from young trees and strong grass ropes. These huts are called Indlu individually and together make up a village called Zululand. Poles from sapling are placed in a circle, bent inwards and fastened together to form the frame, which is the thatched with grass for a roof. A cow dung and anthill mixture form the floor, which is then covered with cattle fat. The construction process is shown in the next slide. The stepwise construction methods are shown in the images to the left side. Step 1 shows the construction of the framework using poles from sapling held together and bent inwards. Step 2 shows further strengthening and proper shape is formed. In step 3, further strengthening is done, and finally in step 4, thatching is done with grass and grasses are held together with rope. Images on the right side explains the sizes of the dwelling. The diameter is approximately 6 to 7 meters, having an approximate height of 2 meters. There are no windows and door opening size is around 90 centimeter by 90 centimeter. Image in the middle on the right side shows the interior view of the Zulu huts. The image below this shows the patterns shown on Zulu houses. These are the vernacular buildings of Cameroon called Obos, which will be discussed in detail in coming slides. Cameroon is the country which lies at the junction of Western and Central Africa. Its Ethnically diverse population is among the most urban in Western Africa. Its capital is Yaounde. The country name is derived from Rio dos Camarões, which means river of prawns. Cameroon's geographical settings. Cameroon is triangular in shape and is bordered by Nigeria to the northwest, Chad to the northeast, the Central African Republic to the east, the Republic of the Congo to the southeast, Gabon and Equatorial Guinea to the south, and Atlantic Ocean to the southwest. Cameroon can be divided into northern, central, southern, and western geographical regions. The rivers of Cameroon form four large drainage systems. Cameroon lies wholly in tropic and is hot throughout the year, having annual mean temperature as 20 degrees Celsius, which is lower in high elevations. Precipitation decreases from south to north. Mean annual precipitation is 2500 mm that occurs in about 150 days. These are majorly having four seasons. First one is light rainy season. Second one is short dry season. Third one is heavy rainy season. And fourth one is long dry season. The wettest part of the country lies in the western highlands. When we look at the settlement pattern of Cameroon, we see there is cultural division between north and the south. Sudanic and Arab pastoralists live in the northern savanna plateau, who migrate seasonally in search of grazing land. Bantu agriculturalists live in forests and hilly south, who live in permanent dwellings. The north is predominantly Muslim, whereas southern people adhere to Christianity and traditional African religions. Population density is greatest in the western highlands, portions of north and southern forest, and along parts of the coasts, whereas it is lowest in the southeastern interior. These are the vernacular oboes in Pos, Cameroon. These are clay oboes of the Musgum people in Pos, Cameroon. And these are similar to Turkish beehive homes in Harran. It provides cooling in the baking heat. These are designed with vents at the top of the building, small entrance and few or no windows. It has high domes which collect the hot air and moves it away from people sleeping at the bottom of the house, making the interior cool. The traditional dwelling units of the Musgum tribe in Cameroon consists of sun-dried mud huts of a shell shape. Height of the domestic structure varies from 3 meters to 9 meters. It needed 6 months for construction. Major building materials used are mud, thatch, water. These are decorated with inverted V's or straight groove lines, which provided foothold during construction and maintenance and also helped in draining of rainwater. On the right side, images show plan and section of typical oboes. The entrance is keyhole shaped, narrow at knee level and wider at shoulder level. A small hole which is left at the top helps in air circulation and also to escape during flood. These holes are closed during rainy season. The construction technique is called mud coil pottery technique. In this technique, layers of mud are placed spirally with lifts of up to 0.5 meters, and each lift, which thins at the top, is dried before the next one is added. A typical farm complex consists of 5 huts, one for the householder, 2 for the woman, one is used as a kitchen, and one for the livestock. Spaces are provided for expansion of housing units as per their needs. All the huts are connected by a clay wall with one door, which is closed at night. At the center of the circular compound within the courtyard, there is a milled granary. This is a Dogon thatch home of Malay. Mali is a landlocked country of Western Africa, mostly in the Saharan and Sahelian region. It is largely flat and arid. The Niger River flows through its interior and functions as the main trading and transport and artery in the country. Some parts of the river flood periodically, which makes the agricultural soil fertile, which are located along banks, and creatures pasture for livestock. Mali is one of the largest countries in Africa, but the population is less, which is mainly centered along the Niger River. There are various ethnic groups. Prominent one is Bambara, along with others like Fulani, Dogon, and Tuareg. Agriculture is the dominant economic sector here, along with cotton production, cattle and camel herding, and fishing. Mali is bounded on the north by Algeria, on the east by Niger and Burkina Faso, on the south by Cote d'Ivoire and Guinea, and on the west by Senegal and Mauritania. Mali has majorly two relief features, plateau and plains, which are crossed by two of Africa's major river systems, the Niger and the Senegal. The highland regions are localized and discontinuous. Mali's drainage system consists of Senegal and Niger rivers and their tributaries. Mali's economy is mainly based on agriculture. Mali's climate. Mali lies within the intertropical zone and has a hot and dry climate. There are two main seasons, dry and wet. The dry season lasts from November to June, having low humidity and high temperature, approximately 25 degrees centigrade. From March to June, average daytime temperature of 40 to 45 degrees Celsius. The country can be divided into three climatic zones, that is the Sudanic, the Sahelian, and the desert zone. Mali is traditionally divided into the nomadic region of the Sahel and Sahara, and agriculture region of Sudanic zone. Around 3/5 of the population is rural, who live in thatched dwellings grouped together in villages of 150 to 600 inhabitants, which is surrounded by cultivated fields and grazing lands. The older towns such as Djane, Timbuktu, Gao and Segon are built in Sudanese style architecture, which has specific characteristics of tall mud walls with wooden limbs and planks that stick out from the surface, which provides a frame for the mud wall and type of ladder that helps in replastering, which is needed to be done every year. Inside, there is a series of wooden columns hold up the roof, which has small openings which allows the sunlight to enter the interior. The Dien Mosque is the epitome of Sudanese architecture, as it is the largest mud building in the world. The vernacular building of Mali, which is most significant, is called Dogon, thatched homes and granaries. Each granary is built from clay supported on rocks. The structures are raised off the ground to keep termites and rodents out. The roof is solid clay with a cap of straw thatch to keep the rain from washing away the clay. There are two types of Dogon granary, that is male granary and female granary. The male granaries are bigger and taller, which stores grains and have more than one door. The female granary is used to store other food items and personal items too, like jewelry, clothing, pottery, etc. Men are generally not allowed to enter a female granary. Generally, roof of female granary is flat without hatch, whereas the pointed roof granaries are male owned. On the left side, the concept of Dogon house is explained. In Dogon culture, the basket, house, village and universe are all organized by the same principles. Dogon baskets are made with a square bottom representing the cardinal points, while circular shaped top represents the celestial vault. Their homes are mixed among the granaries, which are long and designed to represent the human body. On the right side, the dimensions of these Dogon houses and granaries are explained. The pictures, granaries are of sizes of approximately 1.8 meter by 1.8 meter by 4 meters, having opening size of 0.6 meter by 0.6 meters. The images on the right shows Dogon house. The size of Dogon house is approximately 2.5 meter by 2.5 meter by 3.5 meter, having door opening size of 0.6 meter by 1.8 meters and window opening size as 0.6 meter by 0.6 meters. This is the vernacular round houses, which can be seen in Ethiopia, which we'll be discussing in coming slides. Before learning the vernacular architecture of Ethiopia, we must have a brief idea about it. The country lies completely within the tropical latitudes and is relatively compact. The capital is Addis Ababa, located almost at the center of the country. Ethiopia is the largest and most populated country of Africa, and it is one of the world's oldest countries. Now we'll discuss the geographical settings of Ethiopia. Ethiopia is bounded by Eritrea to the north, Djibouti to the northeast, Somalia to the east, Kenya to the south and South Sudan, and the western side is bounded by South Sudan and Sudan. Ethiopia's topography is very rugged, and Ethiopia's relief is classified into five categories based on topographic features. These are Western Highlands, Western Lowlands, Eastern Highlands, Eastern Lowlands, and the Rift Valley. Ethiopia has majorly three principal drainage systems. The first and largest is the Western Drainage System, which includes the watersheds of the Blue Nile, the Tekeze, and the Barro rivers. Climate of Ethiopia needs to be discussed now. It is located in the tropical latitudes, and areas of lower elevation have desert climate, and areas at higher elevations have weather of a temperate zone. Average temperature in highlands is around 10 degrees Celsius, and in lowlands it's around 20 degrees Celsius. There are three seasons found in Ethiopia: long dry season known as Bega, short rainy season called Bela, and hot and dry season and long rainy season. Coldest temperature occur in December or January, and hottest in March, April or May. Looking at the settlement pattern of Ethiopia, 1/5 of the population is found in urban areas and rest live in scattered rural communities, where homesteads are near farm plots to reduce traveling distance. Building plan varies from circular to rectangular style, and these houses are made from locally available materials. Roof are generally thatched. This vernacular building is called round house, found in Ethiopia. This is a traditional split bamboo plated round houses built by Sidama people of Ethiopia. The dome with its pointed top is designed to shed away the heavy rainfall effectively. We will discuss in detail the house form, orientation, and basic construction systems of round houses. The Sidama house is a beehive-shaped structure finished by fixing a layer of undifferentiated woven bamboo onto the structure. Even the partitions inside the house are made of woven bamboo. Most of the houses have two entrances, one at the back and one in the front entrance. Back entrance is used by cattle and front one by humans. The spatial layout of Sidama's round house is: the house has three parts, the residential, the cooking space, and the arkata for cattle or for storage of crops. The interior is accessed porch, and it's divided into oliko, which is further divided into holge, that is parent sleeping area, and bosalo, which is the sleeping area for guests and children. It is also used to store production materials and other small items. The central pole, helicho, is very important in Sidama culture. Now we'll discuss the construction details of the roundhouse. Firstly, we'll discuss its foundation and structure. Juniper tree poles are used as a component for the foundation, which are long lasting and is not affected by termites. These poles are embedded into the ground, and mokolicho, that is strands of bamboo, is used as reinforcement bars placed around the perimeter of the house which can be placed up to 100 to 150 centimeters underground. Hicho are smaller bamboo that are not split and are used for weaving the interior and exterior walls. Looking at the typical roof, it is a dome-like shape which is made with triple layers of bamboo. Splits and ropes are used for structural support, kum sheetal for insulation and rain protection, and woven basket-like cover on the outside ties everything together and protects the house against wind. Now, the wall construction details. The walls are made by splitting the bamboo to smaller strips, and whole bamboo with smaller diameter is used. The interior wall has two different types of patterns, hilo and himbiro. The hilo pattern follows a linear weaved form having a basic parallel appearance, whereas himbiro pattern has a diagonal pattern. The interior wall hut has a finish called lemicho, which can have extra layer called chicha. The chicha can be applied in different colors, patterns and sizes. The materials used for waterproofing, the honche or bamboo sheath is harvested from the skin that the bamboo shoot sheds. Four layers of waterproofing material is applied all around the hut. The exterior wall is weaved with a pattern called fuco, which has an overlaying effect on the facade. This is the vernacular earth tower homes of Togo called Tekianta, which will be discussed now in detail. Let's have a brief introduction of Togo. Togo is a country of Western Africa. Its capital is Lomé, which is located in the southwest of the country and is the largest city and port. Togo gained independence in 1960. Its economy is based mainly on agriculture. Among the smallest countries in Africa, Togo enjoys one of the highest standards of living. Togo's geographical settings. From its 51 km coastline on the Gulf of Guinea, Togo extends northward for about 515 km between Ghana to the west and Benin to the east to its boundary with Burkina Faso in the north. Togo consists of six geographical regions. This region is majorly drained by the Mono River and its tributaries, including Ogo and other smaller rivers. Togo's climate. Togo has a tropical climate. In southern part, rainy season occurs from mid-April through June and from mid-September through October. The narrow coastal zone receives 890 mm of precipitation annually, which is the desert region. The area near Palimé receives the highest precipitation of approximately 1800 mm annually. The north has only one rainy season and average precipitation is 1150 mm. Togo's settlement patterns. Majority of Togo's population live in small villages scattered throughout the rural areas. Rural housing differs throughout the country. Along the coast, there are houses rectangular in shape and built from clay, timber, coconut or palm branches. and topped by double-eaved thatched roofs. Inland in the south, thatched rectangular huts made of adobe are clustered around big trees and surrounded by earthen walls or fence made of palm branches. On the northern side, traditional adobe or stone huts are found, which are circular in shape and are topped by conical roofs or thatched turrets. They are usually gathered in units of family groups, generally enclosed by earthen walls at times, and they were interlinked also. These are the vernacular earth tower homes of Togo, which is called Takienta. These are the homes of the Betemariba, which means those who model the earth. These impressive earth tower homes called Takienta have become a symbol of Togo. These houses can be either single-storied or two-story high. Few of them are having flat roofs and others have conical roof as well. These are generally grouped in villages which include ceremonial spaces, etc. The Takienta generally consists of a cluster of mud structures. The typical house, which consists of around 8 of such kind, girdled together by a continuous mud wall. Each structure has a specific function, for example, kitchen, bedrooms, storerooms, and granaries. These mud walls are made in layers, resulting in a pattern of horizontal stripes. Height of the house varies from 3 to 6 meters, having door openings of approximately 0.6 meter by 2.4 meters. This is a vernacular building of Morocco, which is called Igherim. Now we'll have a brief introduction of Morocco. Morocco is a mountainous country of Western North Africa. Although the country is rapidly modernizing and it enjoys a rising standard of living, it retains much of its ancient architecture and even more of its traditional customs. Talking about the geographical settings of Morocco, it borders Algeria to the east and southeast, Western Sahara to the south, the Atlantic Ocean to the west, and Mediterranean Sea to the north. Most of Morocco lies at high elevations. Two chains of mountains divide eastern from Atlantic Morocco. The Rif Mountains in the north form a buffer along Mediterranean coastline, whereas Atlas Mountains create a barrier across the center. The country has the most extensive stream network in North Africa. Morocco's climate. Most of the Morocco experiences typical Mediterranean climate with mild wet winters and hot dry summers. The rainy season generally extends from October to April. Morocco is on the southern margins of the mid-latitude tract of frontal storm system that regularly transverses the North Atlantic. As a result, rainfall levels are relatively low and decreases from north to south. High pressure ridges periodically develop offshore during the rainy season, shifting storms to the north. When the ridges persist for extended period, it results in drought. The cold Canary Current off the western shores induces atmospheric stability, which further decreases the potential for precipitation. Settlement patterns of Morocco. The settlement pattern in Morocco correspond to three major environmental zones, that is, the coastal plains and plateaus, the highland areas of the Rif and Atlas Mountains, and the desert east and south of the Atlas. The coastal plains and plateaus contain 3/4 of the country's population. For centuries, it has been the home of settled farmers and semi-nomadic tribes. Traditional villages are built for defense and generally perched on hilltop or hill sides. Dwellings are oftenly multi-storied, which are tightly clustered and are built of stone adobe or tamped earth. Mud settlement in this region is a highly distinctive fortified abode. Villages known as Qasr, which means castles, all the settlements is in oasis, most of which are created artificially, either by diverting water from streams or by importing water from mountains, often once some distance through underground tunnels called canals. This is an igham, a fortified granary found high in the Atlas Mountains in the Zawiya Ahensal region of Morocco. It is made from stone and adobe bricks. The igherman home ornate iron and wooden doors and are communally owned by the tribe, providing every family in the village with a room to store grains. Morocco people were blessed to have plenty of sources of fresh water and grazing lands and a landscape easily defended against rival tribes. The region maintained its prosperity and independence for centuries. The highly decorated igharmen were built earlier. This is a vernacular house found in Burkina Faso, which is called Gouronsi. Let's have a brief introduction of Burkina Faso. Burkina Faso is a landlocked country in Western Africa. The country occupies an extensive plateau and its geography is characterized by a savanna that is grassy in north and gradually gives way to sparse forests in the south. The Burkina Faso means land of incorruptible people. Around 1/10 of the population is engaged in agriculture and livestock raising for livelihood over here. Burkina Faso's climate. The climate of this country is generally sunny, hot, and dry. Two principal climatic zones are distinguished, that is, the Sahelian zone in north, which is semi-arid steppe, and the other one is the Sudanic zone, which is found in south, where climate becomes increasingly of tropical, wet, dry type. There are four seasons which can be seen here: a dry, cool season, a hot season, a rainy season, and an intermediate season. Annual rainfall varies from 1000 mm in south to 250 mm in north. Talking about the geographical settings of Burkina Faso, it is bounded by Mali to the north and west, Niger to the northeast, Benin to the southeast, and Cote d'Ivoire, Ghana, and Togo to the south. It is situated on an extensive plateau which is slightly inclined towards the south. The lateristic layer of rock that covers the underlying crystalline rocks is deeply incised by the country's three principal rivers: the Black Volta, the Red Volta, and the White Volta, all of which converge in Ghana to the south to form the Volta River. Burkina Faso's settlement pattern. The population as a whole is unevenly distributed among different regions. The eastern and central regions are densely settled and contain around half of the population. In the remaining regions, the population is scattered. More than two-thirds of people are rural and live in villages, which tend to be grouped towards the center of the country at higher elevations, away from the Volta River valleys. On either side to Volta Rivers, up to several miles, the land is uninhabited due to the prevalence of deadly flies. These are the vernacular earthen homes found in Burkina Faso, which are called Gurunsi. The Kasena people of Burkina Faso make some of the most culturally rich and architecturally beautiful villages like Tiebele, built using traditional Gurunsi vernacular. The dwellings cover a community of around 1 hectare in area and are made of sun-dried mix of clay, soil, straw, and cow droppings, moistened to a perfect mortar, mixed by foot to create strong pottery-like structures, which can be seen in the pictures on the right side of the slide. These techniques preceded the mud brick construction of indigenous people in the area. Layer upon layer are added when needed, maintaining the necessary wall thickness to withstand rainstorms and extreme temperatures. The short walls are used as urban landscaping elements, which provides a buttressing support and offer supplementary places to sit or work. The men build the houses and women decorate the facade with figures having a symbolic meaning. Round small houses named dra belong to young singles, whereas the rectangular ones called bungalow with terrace belong to young couples. The bilobis belong to the older women and young children. The most amazing feature is the intricate ornamentation that covers almost every square inch of the dwellings, painted with colored mud and chalk that tell an impressive story of the ancient tribe's culture. The motifs illustrate about objects used in normal daily life, to religion and belief, to decorative pattern that distinguish one house from the other. The artwork is then embossed with rocks and etchings that highlight the designs and give a truly unique character. The material, along with small openings usually located closer to the ground, assist in comfortable interior temperature. The construction is made with abundant resources found on South site that can be reapplied endlessly. Normally, the door opening size is approximately 0.9 meter by 0.9 meter, which is quite small. These are the fortress type vernacular adobe houses found in Ghana. We'll have a brief introduction of Ghana. Ghana is a country of Western Africa situated on the coast of the Gulf of Guinea. Although relatively small in area and population, Ghana is one of the leading countries of Africa, partly due to its natural wealth and partly because it was the first black African country south of the Sahara to achieve independence from colonial rule. Now we'll discuss the geographical settings of Ghana. Situated on the coast of the Gulf of Guinea in Western Africa, Ghana is bordered to the northwest and north by Burkina Faso, to the east by Togo, to the south by the Atlantic Ocean, and to the west by Cote d'Ivoire. Relief throughout Ghana is generally low, and the drainage system is dominated by the Volta River basin, which includes Lake Volta and the Black Volta, White Volta, and Oti rivers. Climate of Ghana. Ghana's climate is determined by the interplay of the two air masses, a hot dry continental air mass that forms over Sahara and a warm humid maritime tropical air mass that forms over South Atlantic. The mean annual precipitation is 1020 and 1400 mm. Annual mean temperature is 26 to 29 degrees Celsius, and average relative humidity range from 100% in south to 65% in north. The settlement patterns of Ghana. Ghana has three major geographical regions: coastal, forest, and northern savanna. By far the smallest of the region, the coastal zone is traditionally a region of fishermen and small-scale farmers. Almost everywhere agriculture is extensive, and rural settlements form scattered nuclei surrounded by land that is either under crops or undergoing regenerations. These are the vernacular fortress type adobe houses of Ghana. The building is built in traditional style from sun-dried mud bricks, adobe walls, and Y-shaped wooden columns supporting flat roofs made of a bush pole framework covered with mud. Due to the continued invasions and raids from the groups, the people of various regions, the Wala developed their characteristic fortress type houses. The Wala are primarily farmers. Both men and women used to build the houses, and buildings are oftenly renewed. Coming to the conclusion, these are the examples of vernacular architecture of various parts of Africa having different climatic conditions. All the dwellings are made from locally available materials, especially mud, which act as a thermal insulator and helps in protecting against harsh, hot climate and creating comfortable interior. Vernacular architecture evolves over time, reflecting the characteristics of the local environment, climate, culture, natural materials, technology, and the experience of centuries of community building, which can be seen in various examples. Symbolism is another aspect which is experienced in African vernacular buildings. Vernacular architecture imparts sense of place and gives unique identity to a particular place. Thank you.